In this video, a number of questions regarding growth hormone secretion and regulation will be addressed. For starters, in healthy individuals, growth hormone is a hormone synthesized and secreted by anterior pituitary cells called somatotrophs, which are located in the anterior pituitary or the front lobe of the pituitary gland. The pituitary cells release between 1 and 2 mg of the hormone each day. It stimulates the growth of essentially all tissues of the body, including bone. Growth hormone release is not continuous. It is released into the bloodstream in a number of bursts or pulses every 3 to 5 hours in short bursts and at irregular intervals throughout the day. Its levels rise progressively during childhood and peak during the growth spurt that occurs in puberty. But the question is, what triggers its release and how is its release regulated? The release of growth hormone is controlled by two other hormones that are released from the hypothalamus, a part of the brain. The first hormone is called growth hormone-releasing hormone, which stimulates the pituitary gland to release growth hormone, and the second hormone is called somatostatin, which inhibits growth hormone release. Once secreted, HGH remains active in the bloodstream for a few minutes, allowing enough time for the liver to convert it into growth factors, the most crucial being insulin like growth factor 1, which has growth-promoting effects on every cell in the body. Together, IGF-1 and GH promote normal growth of bones and tissues. Although it is likely that most episodes of GH release are spontaneous, the greatest secretion of HGH occurs after exercise and at night during deep sleep, also known as slow-wave sleep. Besides exercise and sleep, growth hormone levels are increased by stress and low glucose levels in the blood. And like earlier mentioned, GH levels increase around the time of puberty. During puberty, a threefold increase in pulsatile GH secretion occurs, the peaks around the age of 15 years in girls and 1 year later in boys. GH secretion is also significantly greater in women than in men and greater in the young than in older adults. During deep or slow-wave sleep, there is an increase in GH secretion. This peak of GH secretion during sleep is essential for body growth and muscle development, as well as tissue regeneration and repair. In an experiment that aimed to monitor GH secretion during sleep at night, it was observed that there was a significant rise in GH concentration in blood within the first 90 minutes from the onset of sleep, but the time it took to reach peak GH secretion ranged from 39 to 165 minutes, and the average time it took to reach peak GH secretion among the subjects was 70 minutes. The rise in growth hormone secretion was gradual, the initial increase being observed 20 to 40 minutes from onset of sleep. Growth hormone concentration in the blood remained high for 1.5 to 3.5 hours before gradually reverting to normal or baseline level. Growth hormone secretion continued to peak and fall throughout the night, though the initial peak that occurred within the first 90 minutes was greatest. During subsequent deep sleep phases, peak growth hormone secretion was delayed if the onset of sleep was delayed. Subjects who were awakened for 2 to 3 hours and allowed to return to sleep exhibited another peak of GH secretion. During the fourth decade of life between ages 30 to 40 years, the total amount of GH secreted over a 24-hour span decreases by 2 to 3-fold. Similarly, the amount of slow-wave sleep decreases dramatically over the same narrow age range. It is speculated that since the longest interval between meals occurred at night, the increased secretion of growth hormone was a response to fasting and the associated need for an accelerated mobilization of free fatty acids. Sleep-related secretion of GH appears to be primarily dependent on the release of growth hormone-releasing hormone, which directly promotes slow-wave sleep. And this peak of GH secretion during sleep is essential for body growth and muscle development, as well as tissue regeneration and repair. Besides during deep sleep, most GH is released during or after exercise. Hence, exercise is one of the most powerful stimulants for HGH production. But not any exercise or exercise protocol is effective when it comes to boosting growth hormone release. The intensity and duration of acute exercise, work output during exercise, muscle mass used during exercise, fitness, and training state influence the GH response to exercise. An exercise intensity above lactate threshold and for a minimum of 10 minutes appears to elicit the greatest stimulus to the secretion of HGH. Exercise training above the lactate threshold may amplify the pulsatile release of HGH at rest, increasing 24-hour HGH secretion. To reach the lactate threshold, you need to exercise at a very high intensity until you experience muscle fatigue. For instance, sprinting as fast as you can for about 20 to 30 seconds at a time with 90 seconds of rest in between your sprints. However, too many repeated bouts of sprinting reduce the GH response, possibly due to negative feedback via elevated systemic free fatty acids. Intensity of exercise may play a key role, with a threshold of exercise intensity necessary before a significant rise in GH levels is detected. Plasma GH concentrations increase within 10 to 20 minutes of aerobic exercise, peak within the exercise bout or immediately after exercise, and remain elevated above baseline for approximately 2 hours after exercise. For both endurance exercises like jogging and resistance exercises like calisthenics or weightlifting, greater activation of anaerobic glycolysis and lactate formation increases the amount of HGH released. For example, research shows that regular resistance exercise, such as the use of dumbbells and bodybuilding machines, lead to increased secretion of HGH and insulin like growth factor 1. Specifically, heavy resistance exercise has been shown to increase growth hormone in both men and women, according to a small June 2015 study published in Growth Hormone and IGF Research, though women experienced a higher increase in hormone levels than men. When it comes to muscle groups that need to be worked for optimal GH secretion during or after exercises, exercises that target the large body muscles, including leg muscles like heavy deadlifts, are more effective than exercises that target the upper body muscles only. GH values are higher if you incorporate heavy leg work into your program. 24-hour integrated GH concentrations are not usually elevated by a single bout of exercise. However, repeated bouts of aerobic exercise within a 24-hour period result in increased 24-hour integrated GH concentrations. Although it has been shown that a single, acute aerobic exercise session results in an increase in GH release during and immediately following exercise, transient decrease in GH release is observed following the increase in GH secretion associated with a bout of aerobic exercise. Hence, a single session or bout of exercise isn't enough to maintain elevated levels of GH concentrations throughout the day. It's observed that 3 30-minute bouts of exercise separated by 1 to 3.5 hours result in a 60% increase in 24-hour GH secretion. Repeated bouts of exercise within 60 minutes of each other did not result in a reduction of exercise-induced GH release, suggesting that exercise may break through GH auto-negative feedback. Laboratory experiments reported that 1 30-minute bout of exercise as well as 3 10-minute bouts of exercise spread throughout the day result in similar increases in 24-hour GH release. GH concentration in the blood is also increased during fasting or when we go at least 24 hours without eating. But one may wonder why this is the case. First, it's suggested that GH is secreted to preserve steady state of glucose, which is the energy source, by promoting lipolysis. Lipolysis is the breakdown of fats which circulate in your blood, also known as triglycerides, into free fatty acids. This process allows the body to mobilize energy during fasting. Second, when we take long without eating, a hormone called ghrelin is released by the stomach. It circulates in the bloodstream until it reaches and acts at the hypothalamus, an area of the brain crucial in the control of appetite. Here it signals the brain that the stomach is empty, and this is when you feel hungry and eager to find something to eat. In other words, ghrelin hormone is released whenever a meal is anticipated, and its secretion falls approximately an hour after meals. Ghrelin is likely a conditioned response that readies the metabolism for an influx of calories. This explains why, according to research conducted on 33 subjects to monitor spontaneous ghrelin secretion during 24 hours, it was ascertained that ghrelin levels are lowest in the morning and hunger is lowest in the morning when you've just woken up, yet you've just gone over 7 to 12 hours on average without eating. However, ghrelin secretion levels don't continually increase even when you ignore hunger. It spontaneously decreases after about 2 hours. That's why you may realize that during fasting, you feel hungry for some time, then a few hours later you feel perfectly okay even when you haven't eaten anything. Thus, if your meal times are fixed, ghrelin secretion is greatest at specific times when meals are expected during fasting and falls after food intake, but ghrelin secretion doesn't fall after ingestion of water. Ghrelin hormone stimulates the release of growth hormone from the pituitary gland. The physiologic role of ghrelin in the regulation of growth hormone secretion is, however, not known. Different nutrients also have different effects on GH release. For instance, certain amino acids stimulate the secretion of growth hormone. Amino acids are the basic building blocks of proteins and they serve as the nitrogenous backbones for compounds like neurotransmitters and hormones. Out of the 20 amino acids required for normal growth and development, 12 can be manufactured by the human body, thus, they are considered non-essential. The other 8 have to be obtained from the foods we eat, thus they are termed essential amino acids, and without them, tissue growth and repair is impaired. All the essential amino acids can be found in protein from animal meats and other animal products. Hence, eggs, dairy and animal meats like beef, fish, pork, and poultry are recognized as complete and high-quality proteins. According to Akram et al., here's the list of all the essential and non-essential amino acids. The most commonly studied primary and secondary amino acids for their effect on GH release, and possibly the most widely used, are arginine, lysine, and ornithine. When an experiment was conducted to assess the effect of amino acids on growth hormone release, it was ascertained that ingestion of 1.5 grams of arginine plus 1.5 grams of lysine by young adults increased plasma GH concentrations 2.7-fold approximately 1 hour from the time of consumption. While ingestion of 1.2 grams of arginine plus 1.2 grams of lysine by young males increased plasma GH concentrations within 30 minutes, and peak GH concentrations were nearly 8-fold greater 90 minutes after ingestion. Ingestion of either 1.2 or 2.4 grams of arginine or 1.2 grams of lysine alone had little effect on plasma GH concentrations. 2 grams of glutamine increased plasma GH concentration 4.3-fold 90 minutes after ingestion. Orally administered arginine plus lysine or glutamine can increase circulating GH concentrations, but other amino acids may not increase GH release. Arginine increases stimulated GH secretion by suppressing the somatostatin secretion at the hypothalamus level. But it is unknown whether glutamine directly affected GH release or acted indirectly through conversion to arginine. Age is determinant of GH response to amino acids ingestion, with younger individuals showing a more robust response. Arginine infusion stimulated GH secretion in all subjects aged 16 to 19, but in less than half of those aged 20 to 29, and in only 18% of those aged 30 to 71. In addition, the timing of amino acid ingestion relative to food consumption is likely to affect the GH response. Relatively low blood glucose levels, such as after a fast or when the stomach is empty, appear to accentuate the effects of GH secretion. Hence, diets high in protein apparently increase basal GH levels. For example, soy proteins stimulate GH secretion when ingested either as hydrolyzed proteins or free amino acids. There are other triggers for GH secretion, especially supplements, but these are the major natural triggers. The different factors that suppress growth hormone circulation in the blood will be discussed in the next video. Thanks for watching. If you liked this video, don't forget to like, comment, share, and hit the subscribe button to watch more videos like this.